how the kids are doing in the school, and the special item for the night is all, well, third grade through. We have our third grade recorder band and all the other instruments playing a couple pieces of music for us through the night. So welcome to our church. We'll have a challenge from God's Word after that, and but it's our parent-teacher fellowship, and when we have these academy functions, we always begin with our pledge to our flag and our national anthem. So please stand with me as we say the pledge to our flag. Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As we pray, Dr. Schreiber is teaching our young men Bible this year, and he'll be leading us in prayer as we begin tonight.
Let's pray. Father, thank you, Lord, for your love for us. We're truly thankful for our school, and in particular on these PTF nights we recall, but are thankful throughout the year. Thankful for all the teachers. Thankful for those that work and labor to teach our children and to teach them not only academics, but discipline and honor in these things, and I'm very, very thankful for our school. As a parent, thank you, Lord. I can't thank you enough for the wonderful school that you've given to us and the opportunity to teach in that school. And so we, as teachers, really do love our students, and we want them to grow up and to understand some truths and to be right with you and to live for you. And so we pray for them, and so it's a privilege to be able to teach. And the rest of the evening, then this evening, Lord, help us to remember our school, to remember you, and to be thankful. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Often at these parent-teacher fellowships, we like to, it's an opportunity for us, the music department, to perform. We get to practice and play to ourselves all the time, but now we have an audience, and hopefully a friendly audience. So our band program begins with, in third grade, with the recorders. My wife has been teaching that class for several years, and so she starts them off on a simple recorder. And then in fourth grade, they start on an instrument, and our fourth grade band will be playing a couple songs for us. And then fifth and sixth graders are together. They meet together. And then in 7th through 12th, we grade that also. We have what we call a junior band and a senior band, or a JV band, you might think, and a senior varsity band. And all of those groups will be playing for you tonight. I'll just mention some more when we get into the fifth grade and up. But to begin with, our recorder band has a couple songs for us to play.
Thank you.
All right, now, fourth graders, just wait. In fourth grade, they have different instruments. Some of them have the same ones, and we use a band method, and first thing we do is we learn three notes. Three notes. You'd be surprised what you can do with just three notes. We're going to do a very simple song first. That is the first three notes that we learned. We learned to play long notes, medium-length notes, short notes, all with those three notes. And then, now some of the students know more notes than this, but I think as a class, we know seven notes. So you can do a lot more with seven notes than you can do with three notes. And so we're going to play two songs for you. First, a simple one that we learned near the beginning of the year, and then the second one is a little more complicated, and we even have them playing different notes at the same time, hopefully. Hopefully they sound right, playing the different notes at the same time. So fourth graders, come on up here, we'll get our stands in place, and we'll play our two songs. Okay, now our fifth and sixth, so in school, our fifth and sixth grade band meets twice a week during the grade school schedule. And our junior band, which is those that haven't met the qualifications, the graded qualifications for senior band, meet twice during the week during the high school schedule. We have five students in the fifth and sixth grade band, and seven in the junior band. So I've combined them, and we're going to play three songs. Just the fifth grade through junior band has three songs for you right now.
Thank you.
So I had an easier song picked out for the senior band, and just so that we'd have enough songs for a program. But we always have too many songs for a program because I talk too much, so just get to it. But the junior band would sometimes get to play with them, and they could play just as well, not just as well, play it very well. And so we've combined junior and senior band on this next song. And so then our senior band will play three more songs. The first one we'll play is a classical piece by Tchaikovsky. It's very soft. It allows us to work on playing nicely, even if we're not playing loud. If you are here on Sunday night, you know us brass players. We like to play loud. But we have to do more than just play loud. So it's Andante Cantabile. It is the name of it. And it's soft. And listen for nice harmonies being played there. And then the next one we'll play is called a Highland Cathedral. It's a processional, and it's really, really it's got a really nice sound to it. And then the last one is a song called Acceptance. It's an original work written maybe about 20 years ago. And the man that wrote it incorporates a hymn that you'll recognize into it. And as we were practicing this song, at first, the music doesn't seem to be making sense. And I think he did that on purpose. It's not that it sounds ugly, but you're thinking, what is happening? What is happening? And as we thought about how the music was making us ask, what is happening? And then the song he incorporates is Horatio Spafford's It Is Well With My Soul. It makes us think, and then he titled it Acceptance. It makes us think, God does things in our lives that we don't understand. But if we're right with God, if we know that he's a part of it, we can accept whatever he gives us and say, it is well with my soul. So if you can think of that as we play that third one, I think it'll help you understand what the composer was trying to do as we play through the third one. So first, Andante Cantabile, then Highland Cathedral, and then Acceptance.
Thank you. He's going to let me speak for a little bit. So, all right, hopefully you enjoy that. I'm thankful to parents who make sure their children practice a lot. It takes a lot of effort to learn an instrument. Before we have our offering, a couple of school things to do. First, I'd like to present the trophies to our Spelling Bee winners. We had the final round of the Spelling Bee this morning, and we narrowed it down to a winner in each grade in the first through sixth grade. So when I read off the winners, they can come down here and get their trophy, and then I'll ask them to stand down at the front. Once they all get down here, we'll give them a round of applause. This year, for first grade, we had William Case as our winner. Come in that direction. Second grade was Angelina Jones. The third grade, for the third time, was Amelia Hume. So she won first grade, second grade, and third grade. And then fourth grade, for the fourth time, she won first grade, second grade, third grade, and fourth grade, is Avery Brown. Fifth grade was Timothy. And in sixth grade, we had another interesting story. Ella Hume won. She won in second grade and then got beat out by Desiree Jones in third, fourth, and fifth grade. And then she got her in sixth grade. So, but Desiree was in the contention all the way along. So let's give them a round of applause. Thank you very much. Be seated. You can be seated. Thank you. You can be seated, Timothy. Yep. All right. Before we have the announcements and the offering, I want to mention one thing. In the library, there are some projects on display. The 9th and 10th graders put together some posters for their literature class, and then the 5th and 6th graders have some history presentations up there. So feel free to walk by and take care of those. And right now, with the window out, there's a special in the books. I'm kidding. Don't do that. If you can get over the wall, no, please. I shouldn't even mention that. All right, a couple of announcements for church. Tomorrow night at 7 is the RU Recovery at the normal time. Saturday is their bus meeting and harvesters meeting at 9:15. And then 8 p.m. in the evening is men's prayer meeting. One upcoming thing to remind us of, Easter Sunday, March the 31st, the morning service is at 10:30, evening service at its normal 5:30 time. Then as the ushers come down, the King's kids will be dismissed during the next congregational song, and then they can stay in King's kids, obviously, through the preaching time, and then through our candy cell meeting. You can let them stay up there and stay in King's kids. And then after the candy cell meeting, make sure you get back up there and pick them up. Our offertory tonight, as Caleb comes to pray for us, is two of our elementary boys, Derek Skeen and Silas Fletcher.
Heavenly Father, thank you for the accomplishments of these students tonight. Thank you for each one of them. I ask that they would be thankful to you for the talents that you've given them. Lord, I ask that you would bless the service this evening and for the offering as we take it up. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
There's a couple relieved parents, right, in that row right there. They've heard that song 500,000 times, and now they can just wipe the sweat off your hands. Yeah, good job, boys. Let's stand and sing number 378. We'll sing this. We'll sing all together on the first verse, and then on the second, the King's Kids and Flyers can be dismissed. Or orchestra, you can be dismissed as we sing the first verse. So stand up for Jesus, number 378.
Stand up. Preach the whole chapter. I'm going to test how many chuckles there were to see how well you knew your Bible. And then those of you who chuckled, I mean, how spiritual are you? You're like, surely he's kidding, right? So that was a double-edged test there. Psalm 119, verse 33. I took Hebrew, the language, with Dr. Schreiber, and He took off and left me in his dust, but it was fun to get some of the language down. Got a couple semesters in. This chapter is broken up into the 22 different letters of the Hebrew alphabet. And speaking of the power of music, I can still sing the Hebrew alphabet, and I don't have time to sing it for you. You have to trust me. We're just way short on time, so. We're going to have to go. But verse 33 is the he portion, there you go, clear your throat there, of Psalm 119. So verses 33 through 40, I'll read that, and then we'll draw some ideas from that. So Psalm 119, verses 33 through 40. Teach me, O Lord, the way of thy statutes, and I shall keep it unto the end. Give me understanding, and I shall keep thy law, yea, I shall observe it with my whole heart. Make me to go in the paths of thy commandments, for therein do I delight. Incline mine heart unto thy testimonies, and do and not to covetousness. Turn away mine eyes from beholding vanity, and quicken thou me in thy way. Establish thy word unto thy servant who is devoted to thy fear. That'd make a great sermon title, wouldn't it? Devoted to thy fear. Devoted to thy fear. Verse 39, turn away my reproach, which I fear, for thy judgments are good. Behold, I have longed after thy precepts. Quicken me in thy righteousness. So I see four things in here, four areas possibly. He says, you know, teach me in these areas. Teach me how to behave like the proper sojourner, the proper soldier, the proper servant, and the proper saint. We'll look at those things. Teach me are those first two words, Psalm 119, verse 33. Teach me, O Lord, the way of thy statutes, and I shall keep it unto the end. The Bible tells us in 1 Timothy 3:15 that we can from the Bible that we can know how we ought to behave in the house of God. This book teaches us how to behave in the house of God and outside of the house of God, and that pretty much covers it, doesn't it? Inside the house of God and out. Teach me how I ought to behave. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your goodness. And Lord, I do ask that you teach us tonight as we look at your precious word. Help us with these things. And again, what a treasure we have in the word of God. And even this precious psalm, Psalm 119, with so much rich truths about the Bible. Teach us tonight. Help us. Thank you for this school. And Lord, we have some good teachers in our school. And our teachers will be the best teachers when they learn how to look to the greatest of all teachers. That is you, O God. And Lord, our goal for our students is for them to learn from us. But one of the greatest lessons we want our students to learn is to set their heart's gaze upon you, O God. And even in these words where you said, give me understanding. Lord, I pray that, Lord, you would show us wonderful truths and then how to apply them in our lives. I pray that you be with us tonight. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. All right, so Psalm 119, here we are in verse 33. Let's start off. It says, teach me, O Lord, the way of thy statutes. So the way, I think of a pathway or as a sojourner. As a sojourner. That's the first one. Teach me to behave as a proper sojourner. Going through this life with a destination, with an end. What does that verse say? Teach me, O Lord, the way of thy statutes, and I shall keep it unto the end. The way, the pathway of his statutes that end there in heaven. You're looking forward to being with heaven, being with the Lord in heaven for all eternity? I know I am. This world is not my home. I'm headed for heaven. But until then, I'm here on this earth, and I'm making my way through my time here, destination, heaven. What does he say? Teach me, O Lord, the way of thy statutes. I shall keep it unto the end. Give me understanding, and I shall keep thy law. Yea, I shall observe it with my whole heart. That idea of observing it with our whole heart, that also reminds us of Matthew 22, verses 37 through 40, when he said, when they said, what's the great commandment? And he said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. He says, I shall observe it with my whole heart. Boy, tonight we're asking, Lord, teach me how to behave as these certain things. And we need to, and he says, if you'll show me, if you'll give me understanding, Lord, I'll set my whole heart to following what you show me. Hopefully that's our desire tonight. Isn't it nice that we can look to the Lord and he gives us direction? Last night, I was picking my wife up and Mrs. Sarah from the airport. They had gone off for some teacher, Christian school secretary training, picking them up. And so going over to Midway and told my phone, I said, give me directions to Midway International Airport. And so it thought through the route, and I hit send. And so I went up to the light, and I was taking a right, and it wanted me to get on the freeway. But just before I got to the freeway, I had a better idea. You know, this long, uninteresting trip would be far more interesting if I had an ice cream to eat while I made the trip. So GPS was telling me, get on the freeway, and my heart was set on something else. So I went right past the freeway, on into town, stopped by the store, and of course, you know, the GPS is just like, wait, you missed, you know, it's like, make a U-turn when possible, turn left, you know, no, what are you, you're not listening to a thing I'm saying, you know, go. And so eventually, after ignoring it for a while, I did finally get back and jump on the freeway and go. But you know, with the GPS, sometimes I know. Remember when you were teenagers and you could sleep through your alarm? It worked the first time or two or three, and then after a while, you learn how to completely tune it out. Boy, God's Word is a GPS for us. Again, I saw the sign on a store on a church sign years ago, and it said, "You want to go to heaven? You need a GPS." And of course, they were saying God's plan of salvation. But you know, God's plan of salvation doesn't just change the here and now, but between here and the blessed there, God has a pathway for us to be on once we're saved and we're His. The way of thy statutes. So sometimes we can tune out the GPS, or we're just like, oh, my heart is set on other things. I don't know, you could have other people talking, you miss the turn that the Bible wants or that you're supposed to make. But I'm so glad that down here I have something that guides every step that I take. Wasn't it fun in the Old Testament there in Exodus 13 when Israel got to enjoy a pillar of cloud by day to direct them, or a pillar of fire by night? You know what I see? God loves to guide us. He loves to direct us. So teach me thy way, O Lord. Teach me the way of thy statutes, and I will keep it unto the end. Then he says, give me understanding. Give me understanding. So understanding seems to be, I can know something, but then to really understand it, it's like when you take a class, and then somebody says, would you teach this class? You go, oh, that's a different level. It's one thing to know the information, but to get to the point where I can give and impart the information, that's something, I'd have to have a real understanding. And the truth is, in life, we can know some things, but how to apply what we know to actual life, well, that's something different sometimes. And here he says, give me understanding, and I shall keep thy law. I shall observe it with my whole heart. So knowledge might be the Pythagorean theorem there. Knowledge might be, well, you can write it down for a test. You can say, well, the square of the hypotenuse is equal to the sum of the squares and the two sides containing the right angle. Okay, so you can maybe recite that. There's some knowledge about geometry. A person may learn that and even learn how to prove it correct on paper without even understanding what they know. You know, Mr. Reinhardt might teach them some math, and they're ready for a test, but they might not have any understanding of how that applies to real life. I remember years ago, Mr. Leslie, I don't know if he even remembers this, we went out somewhere, and he's like, okay, well, we're going to lay out a shed or something. I don't remember what it was, but he goes, we're going to use the Pythagorean theorem. We're going to use the 3-4-5 method. And I'm like, what? Whatever that is. And so he says, well, if we want a square angle, we have to get my measuring tape. We're going to lay this out. And from here, if I know I want to go that way, I'm not sure where the right angle is. So if from here I go out 3 feet that way and then mark it, and then I go out 4 feet this way, and then that can move a little bit, but from here to here I mark 5 feet. Once I have 3 and 4 and then 5, the square of the sum of the two sides of the right triangle add up to the sum of the square of the hypotenuse. If we go from 5 feet that way, then we'll, when I adjust that 5 feet from here to here, then we'll have 90 degrees. And there, and so sure enough, as you think it through, what did it say? The square of the hypotenuse is equal to the sum of the square. So if you have 3 squared is 9, and if you have 4 squared is 16, and then the length from 5 squared is 25, the 9 plus the 16 equals the 25, and you're like, wow. So that those things I learned in school, they actually work. And you can actually apply it to real life. You know, there's Alec. He's looking forward to his senior year being done. Certain books that he'll never hopefully have to crack again. And he's like, Dad, this math book, can I set this aside never to be picked up again? And I'm like, no. You see, what happens is your kids will have math someday. And then they'll bring you those books. And you're like, oh, no, I thought I would never have to. No, but so Mr. Leslie, sometimes you can learn those things. But he would say, well, hey, that knowledge is useful in real life. Let me show you how. And that really is understanding. Boy, you might come to church. You might get some knowledge out of God's word. But then we say, oh, God, give me understanding. How do I take these truths and apply it to real life? That's what I need. And oh, our teacher is so wonderful. He'll help us with those things. Mr. Leslie was a person who could take knowledge and make it useful in real life. And that's what we want from our teacher. Oh, Lord, teach us thy truth. And then teach me how to use that truth in real life. So he teaches us how to behave as a sojourner. Verses 35 and 36, he teaches us how to behave as a soldier. So it says, make me to go in the path of thy commandments. So there I see commandments. Boy, there I'm going to follow my orders. I'm going to be a good soldier. And the Bible talks about being a soldier, doesn't he? There in 2 Timothy 2:4, where we want to please him who hath chosen us to be a soldier. Now here it gets confusing. Listen. Make me to go in the paths of thy commandments, for therein do I delight. Wait a second. You can delight in commands? I thought commands were hard. But again, the Bible tells us, no, not his commands. 1 John 5:3 reminds us his commands are not grievous. And then this idea of delighting, of course, we can go back to Psalm chapter 1, verse 2. In his law doth he meditate, that blessed man. In his law doth he meditate, and he delights in those things. His delight is in the law of the Lord. So here he says, make me to go in the path of thy commandments, for therein do I delight. Incline my heart unto thy testimonies, and not to covetousness. So I see as a soldier here. So teach me, Lord, to behave as the proper sojourner, going through this life with my destination heaven. Teach me to be tuned into the GPS of your word, trusting you to guide me as I go along. And then secondly, as a soldier, following commandments, following orders, and even delighting in them. My son loves history. And so there's Civil War, and so many times the cavalry is out trying to do reconnaissance. So many times in war, the losing army might very well have won if they had better intelligence. Oh, that happened time after time after time. Oh, the secrecy that was important to the landing at Normandy. All the extent that they went to make sure that was kept secret and all those things. Well, when you belong to the Lord's army, guess what? Our intelligence is superior. Oh, to follow the Lord. In fact, when he loves, again, how frustrating it is at times when military commanders, unthinking of their armies, will throw them into some dangerous thing. Oh, we'll just throw another battalion. Let's throw another. And then just people sent into a meat grinder. Oh, that's not our Lord, is it? He loves every person in his army. He knows what the best course of action is. Oh, it's not only, oh, I'm really glad that he knows best, but we're foolish if we don't trust our commander. So, delighting in God's word, you're like, oh, that sounds good. Yeah, okay, next point. But here's the thing. We don't always delight in his commandments, do we? Paul talked about this in Romans chapter 7, verses 22 and 23. So he said, for I delight in the law of God. Oh, so far, so good. After the inward man, verse 23, but I see another law in my members warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. You're like, well, hold on a second. You mean you delight in God's law, and then there's other times where there's something inside of you warring against those things? You mean sometimes you feel like you love the commandments of God, and other times you loathe the commandments of God because they get in your face and say, what you want is no. And Paul seemed to, I feel like a pendulum going back and forth. Me, what God wants, what I want, what God wants, what I want. And just back, who will deliver me? The thing is, it's wonderful when God's law is a delight, but a lot of times because of that old nature, it's not the delight that it's supposed to be. When we're saved, we have that new man and the old man. They fight against one another. And really, he talks about it in verse 37. We'll get there in a minute, where he says, turn away mine eyes. But really, it's the gaze of our heart. Where's the gaze of our heart set? Sometimes the gaze of our heart is set on me. What do I want? What do I want? And other times, as a believer, hopefully, the gaze of our heart is set on God. What does he want? Oh, he's so good. I want to please him. And so he goes into this next verse. He says, incline my heart. Help me, Lord. Deliver me from vacillating. Back and forth. Back and forth. Help me, Lord. Less of me, more of you. He brings up something interesting here when he talks about covetousness. Covetousness, he says, incline mine heart unto thy testimonies and not to covetousness. Seems to be a little bit of a besetting sin in there. And of course, what is covetousness? Well, that's I want more. I want more for me. I don't have enough. More for me. I don't have enough. It's one of the Ten Commandments, right? Commandment number 10 warns us, it commands us to beware, to not be covetous. And so what can I do, O Lord? Well, in Hebrews 13:5, he talks about that. He says, let your covetousness, or let your conversation be without covetousness. So your life, your conversation, your life, let your conversation be without covetousness and be content with such things as ye have. So instead of focusing on what we don't have, focus on what we do have because of him. And not just on what we have, but on who we have. The verse goes on. It says, be content with such things as ye have, for he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Again, the gaze of our heart on God. He said, Lord, there's not enough in my pockets. And God says, there's plenty in mine. Well, what does that have to do with me? Well, if you just gaze on me and trust me as your heavenly Father, you're supposed to be looking to me every day anyway, aren't you? Aren't you supposed to, when ye pray, say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. I'm the provider. Isn't it more exciting for you that my pockets are full? Why do your pockets have to be full if your heavenly Father's pockets are full? Oh, covetousness has a way of coming in and causing us to lose sight and not be the right soldier with our gaze upon our great and glorious commander, whose commandments are not grievous, and we can delight in those commandments because he's so good. So teach us, Lord, to be the right sojourner, the right soldier. Here in verses 37 and 38, it says this, turn away mine eyes from beholding vanity, and quicken thou me in thy way. Establish thy word unto thy servant, thy servant. So thirdly, he teaches us how to behave like the right type of servant. And again, those precious words, listen to that. Thy servant who is devoted to thy fear. Thy servant who is devoted to thy fear. All those sound like so powerful, powerful words. Talking to my CE class today, we said, you know, in this life, we tend to see what we're looking for. And we tend to hear what we're listening for. So be careful as you walk out the door in the morning what you're looking for and what you're listening for. Lord, help me to be looking to and listening for you today. And oh God, please deliver me from the siren song of this world and the visual delights of the devil's display. Doesn't that Lord's model prayer for us go on and say, Lord, deliver me from temptation. Lord, help me, oh God, I need you. Help me, deliver me from sin and temptation. He said, turn away mine eyes from beholding vanity. Fanny Crosby, the blind poetess, right? She said, boy, I've never been able to see what this world has to offer. I've been blind to those things, but I've had eyes of faith unto eternal things, and I pity so many that have their eyesight. What? You pity those that have their eyesight? Oh, yes, because so many of them can see what this world has to offer, but they're oh so blind to the things of eternity. Boy, he said, turn away mine eyes from beholding vanity. Wouldn't it have been wonderful if David would have turned away his eyes when he looked out and saw Bathsheba not clothed the way she should have been clothed? Oh, if he would have just turned away his eyes. Nope. Nope, heading back inside. Pack my bags. I'm heading out to the battlefield where I belong. Turn away your eyes, the Bible says. Turn away mine eyes from beholding vanity. Oh, that Eve would have turned away her eyes back in Genesis 3. Instead of gazing on that forbidden fruit. What does the Bible say? Genesis 3:6. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, wouldn't it be so much better if it said, when the woman saw, she turned away her eyes. But it doesn't say that, does it? Oh, the power of our eyes, what we gaze upon. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took the fruit thereof and did eat. Boy, even in your mind's eye can go to the wrong place. I find myself, even as a 45-year-old pastor, reel that brain back in. Lord, help me to have my thoughts where they should be, thinking of those right things in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Help me, Lord. Turn away mine eyes. He asks the Lord to help him with those things. And then he says, establish thy word unto thy servant who is devoted to thy fear. You know, some will hear God's word and forsake it. That doesn't matter a whole lot to me. Some will hear God's word and forget it. Oh, yeah, that sounds important. And then quickly they see something else. Now their attention is on something entirely different. Oh, that sounds interesting. And maybe even something that I would order my life around. Squirrel. But there are some that will hear God's word and fear it. Oh, these words, let that sink in. Establish thy word unto thy servant who is devoted to thy fear. Establish thy word unto thy servant who is devoted to thy fear. These words are the very words of God. They matter. They matter far above everything else. On Tuesday, Dr. Schreiber preached out of Psalm 19 about the great transgression. And we human beings down here, we'll size up our sin, won't we? We'll say, well, that's a big sin, so that's probably off limits. But that's a little sin, so it's not that bad. And basically, he was kind of saying, he said, why do we look at our sin and size up our sin and decide which sins are fine? Get your eyes off your sin and onto the one you're sinning against. When your gaze is on the one you're sinning against, no sin is okay. Turn your eyes upon him. Gaze full in his face. All sin is grotesque before the awesome purity and holiness of Almighty God. Oh, you know, teach us, Lord, to behave like the right type of servant. And you know what the right type of servant looks like? Well, he asks, oh God, establish thy word unto thy servant who is devoted to thy fear. And then the last thing here, verse 39, turn away my reproach, which I fear, for thy judgments are good. Behold, I have longed after thy precepts. Quicken me in thy righteousness. Quicken me in thy righteousness. Teach me how to behave as the right type of saint, the right type of saint. Oh, you know, when I got saved, I joined the family of God, and I became a saint. Quicken me in thy righteousness. My righteousness is no good. There in Isaiah 64, 6, it says my righteousness are as filthy rags. Quicken me. Make me alive in thy righteousness. Boy, the day I got saved, he cleansed my sin and he put his robe of righteousness. He clothed me. He gave me spiritual life. I began trusting him, and still today I have to go on trusting him. Lord, you gave me life. I'm still trusting you for the strength I need to live a life honoring to you. The life that I gained from you, I'm looking to you. Help me to live set apart unto your righteousness. He says, turn away my reproach. He seems to be talking about the scorn of his enemies. He uses the term turn away. He says those same words in verse 37 regarding turning away his eyes from vanity. So as he says, turn away my reproach, he seems to be saying my enemies are scornfully saying awful things about me. Oh, God, won't you step in and help me? Do something. Lord, would you take away the reproach that they're heaping upon me? It seems like David had prayed these words back in 1 Samuel 17:26 when he came on the scene. And there was Goliath down there opening his mouth, great swelling words against the God of heaven. And David prayed these, or he mentioned these words as he came on the scene, and he's like, hey, are we just going to let him say those things? He said that in 1 Samuel 17:26. And David spake to the men that stood by him, saying, what shall be done to the man that killeth this Philistine and taketh away the reproach from Israel? Oh, God, he shouldn't be allowed to say those things. Would you do something about it? Would you do something about it? And God allowed David himself to go down and do something about it. But here he says, turn away my reproach. Oh, God, they're saying awful things about me. But, Lord, you're able to do something about it. Would you turn away my reproach? And we know that soon after, after he had mentioned this and he looked to the Lord, soon after, Goliath's great and swelling words were no more. So, David asks the Lord to teach him. And that's what we believe God has allowed Fairhaven to be a part of, directing the attention of our young people to the real teacher, helping parents who hold the main responsibility of educating their kids and setting their heart on the things of God. But the school is a blessing because it pools our skill sets. Mr. Reinhardt and Mrs. Gachette, they're way better at math than I am. I'm glad my kids can sit under people with different skill sets, and we can pool some of those skill sets from a godly vantage point, and thus we have a Christian school. Mrs. Case has a far deeper knowledge and appreciation of English and literature. I'm glad that they can get some of those things from her. And there's so many others that I can learn from. But all of us, we will continue to look to the greatest teacher of all, our God. So what was that first verse? Teach me, O Lord, the way of thy statutes, and I shall keep it unto the end. Teach me to be the right type of sojourner down here, Lord. Not, this world is not my home. I'm passing through. Teach me to be the right type of soldier, following commandments and delighting in those things and not being turned aside by covetousness. Teach me to be the right type of servant, devoted to thy fear. Lord, help me. Again, the Bible says, Proverbs 9:10, I believe it is, that the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. Boy, you have a young person who's devoted to his fear. Oh, that's a wise person. Beginning of wisdom is that fear. And then the right type of saint, looking to the Lord to be quickened in his righteousness and living like we should. Teach me, O Lord, the way of thy statutes, and I shall keep it unto the end. Mr. Reiner.
All right, before before we pray to dismiss here, just a reminder that the kids can stay in King's Kids, and those of you involved with Candy Cell will have a meeting down in the chapel right away. Let's pray. Lord, we ask that you would continue to be with our school. Lord, thank you for the privilege to be part of it. Lord, we ask that you would give Pastor Mitchell wisdom as he pastors and guides and leads us. Thank you for the message we heard tonight. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.